Nieben Hao, guten Abend and welcome to the cinema of the DFF, the Deutsches Film Institut and Film Museum. My name is Laura Teixeira. I work here in the cinema department and I welcome you all to another evening of our lecture and film series dedicated to the work of Jia Zhangke. I'm very happy to have a guest tonight, Winnie, who we're going to be hearing more about in a few moments. I would just like to, first of all, thank all our partners. This has been a long-running cooperation between the DFF and the Department of Theatre, Film and Media of the Goethe University, as well as the Research Center Connormative Orders. And we are very happy to have, for this particular series, also the cooperation with the Sinology Department of the Goethe University and the Confucius Institute also at the university. And tonight we'll have Professor Miriam Troster, who will be presenting the guest of tonight, and I'm very happy that she's helping us with the moderation as well after the film. So I welcome you all to stay after the film to ask your questions about the film and about the lecture. I thank you all for coming and have a nice evening. And now Professor Troster will present our guest of the evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Laura, and good evening. I would like to grab the opportunity first to actually thank both the Film Museum and the Film Studies Department at Goethe University to organize this series and also to make this cooperation possible. It is my great pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Winnie Yilaiman, who will give today's lecture on A Touch of Sin, and as I've heard, also two additional films by Jia Zhangke today. Dr. Yi is assistant professor in comparative literature at the University of Hong Kong. She's currently also Carson Fellow at the Rachel Carson Center for Environment and Society at Ludwigs Maximilian University in Munich. Dr. Yi graduated from the University of Hong Kong, did her postgraduate studies at Warwick and Lyon, and her PhD at the University of Hong Kong. Befitting this transnational trajectory, as well as her current department's interdisciplinary approach, her research interests are multifaceted and cross different media. They range from, for instance, contemporary Chinese language literature and film to cultural studies on Hong Kong, and from eco-criticism to post-colonial studies, to name just some examples. She has published on literature and film from both China and Hong Kong, with her publications showing a keen interest in questions of locality, memory, material objects, and the environment. Dr. Yi's publications have appeared in journals such as Communication and the Public, Jump Cut, Environment, Space, Place, and, for example, the Handbook of Asian Cinema, and Ecology and Chinese Language Cinema. She has co-edited Narrating Hong Kong Culture and Identity, published by Oxford University Press, and just recently, or last year, edited a special issue of Asian Cinema on Asian eco-cinema. As regards film, Dr. Yi has done extensive research on eco-cinema, as we've just heard, and Hong Kong independent and activist film, including the role of documentaries, but also on Chinese urban cinema and, important for us today, Jia Zhangke. This ties in very well with her current research project at the Carson Center, as a Carson Fellow, which is entitled The Urban in the Ruins, Studies of Ecotopia in Chinese Texts in the 2000s, and which will be part of a monograph on the relationship of ruins, nature, and creativity in post-socialist literature and film. As this suggests, we can look forward to learn more about Chinese urban cinema and especially about the circulation of objects in Jia Zhangke's A Touch of Sin and, as I just mentioned, other films today. A Touch of Sin, which weaves a dense web of intermedial connections, is a very complex film with many aspects worth discussing. Although it has been argued that the film can be seen as the beginning of yet another stage in Jia Zhangke's career, some themes, motives, stylistic devices, and maybe even some characters in the film will certainly ring familiar to many of you who have been here for weeks or months now. So welcome again, Winnie. The floor is yours.
Thank you. So good evening, everyone. Thank you for the very generous introductions. And I have to thank, you know, the Film Museum and the Film Institute, you know, for bringing me here from Munich. As you know, you just heard, I'm not just going to talk about A Touch of Sin this evening, but then I'm going to bring in two other films of Jia Zhangke, you know, to articulate, you know, these issues of the circulation of objects. So hopefully that, you know, we can open up, you know, the discussion, and so that, you know, you can, you know, share with me later, you know, how do you, you know, look at, well, objects, you know, and among other things, you know, in Jia Zhangke's work. Okay, so actually I'm very interested in the way that migration, the migrant workers are being depicted, you know, in Jia Zhangke's movies. And I think, you know, the 21st century globalization has given rise to this new wave of mass migrations, which the frequent crossing of borders has made the kind of diaspora experiences very common. But I think in the case of post-socialist China, however, there's a very unique situation, which is the problem of internal displacement. So migrant laborers from the countryside have flown to the industrial cities for jobs in sweatshops or coal mines and rarely returned to the homes that they left. Prolonged internal migration has become, you know, part of their destiny. So still, there is no guarantee of permanence for those, you know, who remained attached, you know, to the land, who chose, you know, to stay behind. Since one's home can, without notice, be slated for demolition due to the new state policy or large-scale development projects. So China, you know, has actually engaged, you know, in this kind of perpetual demolition and ruination and construction for the past three decades. So this is, you know, just a chart, you know, to what get started, you know, with the discussion. In 2010 and then 2012, you know, this is the chart about, it officially becomes a predominant, you know, urban country with over 50% of the population registered, you know, as urban residents. So urbanization definitely, you know, is not only moving at an unprecedented speed, but also as the major cause, you know, of displacement, which is, of course, you know, is a major theme, you know, in Jia Zhangke. So I argue that, you know, Jia Zhangke's movies, you know, forces audience to face the impact of this reckless development. Okay, and then what I'm going to talk about, you know, this evening is going to be about these three themes. In these three works, you know, I argue that, you know, the text underscore the passivity, you know, of the displaced who endure the tragic transformation of their lives, you know, without protest somehow. But then their silence and acceptance reflect the most terrible aspect, you know, of this brutal urbanization. As in these three films, I think it also shows us that there is possibility of reconnection, but then through the circulation of objects. Objects, you know, reconnected displaced migrant workers in still life, you know, the one that is on the left, and then draw attention to the transnational nature of commodities in useless, which is a documentary. Highlight the kind of cross-media relationship of Chinese literature and film genres in A Touch of Sin, you know, the film that you're going to watch this evening. So Jia's critique of the destruction wrought by urbanization in the name of progress, therefore, is not entirely without hope. And then there's still possibility, you know, for resistance, you know, through this use, adoption, you know, and appropriation, you know, of the object. And then I will start the talk, you know, with this idea of affect. So one could argue that the function of art, and especially the cinema, is to capture a moment in a rapidly changing landscape and register its significant form. This freezing of space-time continuum provides filmmakers with the opportunity for reflection, an opportunity that is often withheld, however, you know, for both filmmakers, you know, and the audience. So Jia Zhangke, who is widely, you know, being known for through the film festival circuit, has seen many of his films actually banned, you know, at home. They do not have the opportunity to be shown, you know, to the people of mainland China, who are both his subject and also his targeted audience. So in a way, Jia, you know, has been doubly marginalized, you know, from his nation and also, you know, from the country, you know, that he loves. So, but then I think since the production of The World in 2004, however, there is this rejection, you know, has gradually, you know, tempered, you know, has taken the steps necessary to return, you know, to the local market and to have his films approved, you know, by the Film Bureau. So, however, I think his films still very much convey this sense of displacement that he himself, you know, felt, not only in their very pessimistic view of urbanization, but also in the portrayal of art as a means of reconstructions and reconciliation. So for this reason, I think affect, you know, figures largely, you know, in Jia Zhangke's films. Just borrowing, you know, Brian Masumi's work here, citing, you know, Spinoza, you know, Masumi maintains that affect, you know, is the capacity for affecting and being affected in the same time.
human contains these two capacities, you know, which I quote here. Ogun quote, when you affect something, you're at the same time opening yourself up to being affected in turn, end quote. The idea of allowing feelings to take center stage and treating actions as secondary can be applied to the concept of belonging, which again, you know, is a very important motif, you know, in Jia Zhangke's work. In an age where places are not stable and homes are insecure, the only possible anchor is our relation with one another. And then it's also useful, you know, to apply Barr's, you know, notion of homing desire here in this particular context of Jia Zhangke's works. Barr, you know, I quote, you know, here, argues that it is crucial to differentiate the homing desire from the desire for a homeland. While the latter, you know, is linked with the idea of return and diaspora, the former actually suggests the desire for security and belonging. Although Jia Zhangke's work did not conform precisely to this model, but they can be illuminated by his idea of homing, which allows us, the audience, to conceive of home not as necessarily a topography, but as a relationship that one can build on. So coming home refer less to the return to a particular place, especially, you know, to the migrant workers where they don't have any homes to return to. But then, you know, it is to an attempt to build a relationship. Migrant laborer stories do not occur on an epic scale or provide happy endings often. They focus on very difficult moments in life. So as we can see it, there are actually three ways, you know, for the migrant workers in Jia Zhangke's work who try to revive the notion of home by relating to the commodities, by relating to the physical experiences, and by relating to a common cultural memories. So I will first, you know, start with the discussion on still life. I will analyze, you know, the diaspora experiences depicted, you know, in the film. These are very familiar, you know, to the Chinese population and are an inevitable product of shifting paradigms, you know, in the political, economic, and social realms. They're rarely, you know, the choice of individuals' ambitions. Instead, they're actually a condition that shapes the Chinese post-socialist, you know, experience. Often, you know, it becomes also a constant and never-ending experience as well. In Jia Zhangke's still life, you actually see the city dwellers are forced, you know, to leave their homes because of a national agenda, which is the construction of the Three Gorges Dam. So rather than focusing, you know, on the geographical relocations such as those undergone by the migrant workers, like depicted in Dong, or the workers at the state-owned factory 420 portrayed in 24 Cities, you know, these two other films, you know, by Jia Zhangke. I think in this particular film, Jia's attempt to present displacement in rather, you know, dialogical terms. So displacement, you know, is inevitable, forced, and imposed, but such alienating situations generate new kind of relationships and feelings that allow people to retain their sense of humanity and hope. So in a way, exile strengthens the notion of home by making it flexible. Okay, I should still stick to this one first. Extra strengthens the notion of home by making it flexible. Homing involves both locating home and the ability, you know, to locate home. So actually, you know, the ability to locate home, to find the connections, you know, to this home, whether it is imagined or real, is actually more important because it relies on people's capacity to devise actions and strategies. So home is not located elsewhere, you know, in Jia Zhangke's films, but it is the process of searching. So for Jia Zhangke, the process of learning what home is and not is crucial. And the films, you know, that including Still Life and the other two films that I'm going to talk briefly about this evening, do not portray the homes, you know, as of the displaced as broken and non-existent. Instead, they deal with the people's continued efforts to reconstruct the idea of home in their everyday lives through rekindling the relationships between objects and memories, between popular culture and cultural imaginaries, and between topography, you know, and affect. So this is a screen grab, you know, from Still Life. Still Life depicts the demolition of the city of Fengjie. It sank into the Yangtze River because of the construction of the Three Gorges Dam. So the residents lost their homes overnight. The inhabitants were not only unable to save the city, but they were forced, you know, to participate in the destruction, become, you know, the workers, you know, of destruction, abandon their homes and remain silent witnesses. To the routine demolition, the residents reacted with seeming indifference. The film does not show either sorrow or remorse. And the only person who actually continued to search the place. Through the rubble is actually an outsider, a miner named Tang Shanmin, you know, the man, you know, on the right. The only remaining evidence of the city is actually an address inscribed on a cigarette paper that he actually, you know, is holding. Shanmin, who came from Fengyang to look for his ex-wife, whom he had not seen for 16 years, holds on to a flimsy address she left him. So the idea of home is actually both challenged and reinforced by this flimsy paper, cigarette paper. And then also, you know, this is both challenged and reinforced by a foreigner, to someone that is outside, you know, of the city. His presence actually reminds, you know, the inhabitants that displacement is not inevitable and that hope is not shattered because he is the one who is still looking, you know, trying to, well, sort of like reinvent, you know, this place, this home. The stark contrast between the easily discardable jotted address and a solid physical home it represents, you know, is actually very striking. And it gives, you know, the audience a sense of the possibility of re-enchantment through, you know, this paper. And through that paper, you know, to rekindle a kind of relationship, you know, of an imagined home. And it is also very interesting to note that the film is actually divided into four sections, and each section is named, you know, after an object. So cigarettes, liquor, tea, and toffee, so the sweet. I think these titles, you know, themselves also suggest that commodities could well be the last thing one can hold on to in the age of demolition and in the age, you know, of post-socialist China. Here, commodities do not represent fetish, as the Marx or the Frankfurt School pioneers, you know, would argue. Instead, it was actually, as Jane Bennett maintains, they contain the possibility of re-enchantment because affect itself is both deep and never entirely predictable in its movements. And the element of this unpredictability also opens up the possibility that commodities operate not only with mind-dulling repetition that you consume every day, but also with an ethic-enabling spiral repetition, something that can be generated, you know, out of your relationship with it. And I would argue that, you know, the objects in still life serve to stir up that kind of unpredictable effect in interpersonal relationship and also in the relationship between people and objects as well. So as the theme sort of like progress, the other means of reconnection is through objectifying nostalgia. So meaning projecting nostalgic feelings onto objects and replacing the sense of displacement with objectified, you know, memories. So there is one very important scene, you know, in the theme, which it's the one that on the left-hand side. It is a scene where all the migrant workers, they gather, you know, after lunch and at the demolition site. So they started, you know, small talk, you know, with each other. And then one of them, you know, took out, you know, this $10 renminbi note. And then at the back, you know, of the note, it says a landmark, you know, of the city. So the migrant workers, you know, started to think about the landmarks in their own cities and their hometowns. And they started, you know, sharing, you know, their memories of home. I think, you know, in that particular sequence, it clearly shows that, you know, the way how a commodity, you know, how, well, a banknote is able, you know, to connect, you know, this bigger community, you know, which is, well, cross, you know, geographic. And I also argue that, you know, the quotidian objects, like, you know, the banknote itself, can actually create kind of emotional alliances among the characters themselves, as well as, you know, this cultural, you know, boundaries. So the materiality provides an avenue through which new forms of attachment that replace home can be produced, even in this very scene, you know, of devastation. And there are also other objects such as the cigarette paper, banknote, and then the toffee, the sweet. They are also remnants of a lost time and represent a kind of nostalgia for an attachment, you know, to an imagined, you know, home. So, okay. So this is towards the end, you know, of Still Life that you see Han Xiangming, you know, the migrant worker, manage, you know, to find, you know, his wife. And then they're actually sharing, you know, a small piece of sweet, you know, the toffee, you know, with each other, you know, as, you know, the film, you know, draws to a conclusion. In Still Life, you know, people drift about and trying to find others to complete them. So Han Xiangmin, you know, travels, you know, from Shanxi to Fengjie to look for his ex-wife. And then there's another character, you know, in the film, Shen Hong, who also goes, you know, to Fengjie to look for Guo Bin, you know, the husband who left her 2 years earlier. So there is this frequent movement, you know, in the film that you can see, and looking for connections, you know, looking to rekindle, you know, emotions, you know, with other people. So I think, you know, this is particularly important, you know, for those uprooted from their homes, you know, for the migrant workers, you know, who well, have no choices, you know, but left home, you know, in order to have a better life. It is necessary to reimagine one's sense of belonging. So portraying that kind of connections, which is horizontal in spatial terms and vertical in temporal terms, I think, you know, the film manages to emphasize a new home that echoes the diaspora experiences, but then a home that can only, you know, be elsewhere. So I will actually skip something and quickly move on to the second example of my presentation, which is a documentary titled, you know, Useless. So in this particular, you know, documentary, you know, it is about fashion and also about, you know, the fashion designer, the Chinese fashion designer Ma Ke, which you will see in center, you know, of the image. So while I argue that in still life, you see the horizontal connection that is highlighted, that explore the possibilities of reconnection outside of hometown or kinship, in Useless, there is an other kind, you know, of relationship, you know, that objects, you know, helped to rebuild or to reinvent and reconnect, which is fashion, you know, commodity. Useless, you know, the title of the documentary, which is also the name of the fashion line by this Chinese fashion designer Ma Ke. It's interesting. It just has a tripartite, you know, structure, which is adopted in an effort to capture the full extent of global capitalism that you can witness through the circulation in our fashion. It explores the ways Ma Ke uses fashion to reflect on a life outside of modern consumer culture. After graduating, so a bit of background, after graduating from Central St. Martin's College of Art in London with a specialty in women's wear, so Ma Ke returned to China to establish her own brand. In the late 1990s. And in the mid-2000s, she embarked on this non-commercial collection, which is called Useless, and which is also, the, of course, you know, the main subject, you know, of the documentary. It is a unique line of fashion that cannot be easily copied or purchased in fashion boutiques or department store. And this uniqueness of her fashion has been recognized internationally. So he's been invited, you know, to present at the Paris Fashion Week, and also to have, you know, this collection, you know, being shown at the London's Victoria and Albert Museum in 2008. So the uniqueness of this particular fashion line for me is, as Kelvin Hui, you know, scholar said, that her work intends to draw attention to the loss of the emotion bond between the maker and the user of clothes in the age of industrialized mass production and consumption. So her intention is to reconnect commodities with time, space, and ecology in an era of fast fashion. And her work reinforces the importance of craftsmanship as opposed to kind of mass production. So the Useless line, the fashion line, is carefully sewn by women working on handlooms, you know, in Ma Ke's workshop in China. And the emphasis on craftsmanship can be interpreted as a return to the pre-industrialized times when the producer has a direct connection with the product. The physical act of human production counteracts the modern alienation associated with mass production and consumption. So by making the clothes with their hands, the women who work in Ma Ke's shops have re-enchanted fashion. One is reminded of the famous line in a Tang poem, which is also brought up, you know, by Ma Ke in the documentary. This very famous line in Tang poem is, "The mother stitches for her traveling son," which evokes a picture of a mother stitching clothes for her son because he has to travel far away. So it is the hope of the mother that by wearing, you know, the clothes, the son, you know, will be able to feel and, well, sort of like remember that kind of emotion that is connected with the mother and also with the clothes that he is wearing. So that kind of physical attachment that is being focused. So it is the mother's hope that the love and concern of for his son can be channeled and mediated, you know, through the stitches, through, well, the cloth. Maternal love therefore infuses the clothes, which are transformed into a kind of embodiments of memories, rekindling the affective relationship between objects, you know, and people. So Ma Ke, you know, intends, you know, to emphasize the fashion, you know, becomes and can be that kind of medium to, well, rekindle, you know, the kind of affective emotions, you know, between humans, you know, and the objects, and also can be carried on through, you know, memories and also physical, you know, experiences. So for Marker, this kind of handmade fashion not only conveys love, but also recovers lost memories. So in this particular fashion line that she created, the garments produced for the useless line are actually buried in the soil for a period of time. So when the garment is unearthed, Marker maintains that it will be imprinted with the time and space of soil with the dirt, you know, on it. So the dirt endows the garment with a physical history and also transform it, you know, from a garment that forgets, you know, we throw away, you know, our clothes, you know, when it is no longer, you know, a la mode, to a garment that remembers because of the dirt, because of the time that is being imprinted, you know, on the clothing through that process, you know, of being buried, you know, in the soil. So practically, this represents a significant return, you know, to the nature, reminding consumers of the waste that is generated when people chase after fashion trends and treat, you know, commodities as disposable items. So the clothes that is being buried does not have to be a symbol of waste, you know, because you throw it away, you know, you sort of like left it, you know, in the dump site. But it actually can be an enchanted object in Marker's reflection of it. And also very symbolically, dirt, you know, it's itself challenges bourgeois and modern notions of linear time because it contradicts, you know, the kind of modern notions of, well, hygiene and, you know, and cleanliness. It disrupts, you know, the capitalistic narrative of progress, development and modernization. And in an opposite way, it represents a kind of slowness, duration and history. So somehow, you know, it functions quite well that it counters the narrative of progress of modern capitalism. So I have to go back, you know, to Jane Bennett a bit again, because Jane Bennett's theory, you know, maintains that the disillusionment of the Enlightenment led to a tendency to stifle our affection for the world and discourage vitality in both the human and the non-human, the natural and the artificial. So she calls our attention to the minor tales of the people, the older tales of the everyday, which allows the world to be re-enchanted. So I think, you know, borrowing, you know, her idea, Marker's garments actually support, you know, Bennett's theory very well. They deal not only with links to the material world, but also with the affective relationship among bodies, objects, and urban space. So this stress, you know, on the value of the minor tales, because they can call attention to the magical sites that are already there. So I think, you know, these magical sites, you know, it's translated into Marker's fashion line would be, you know, the kind of clothes, you know, that she produced, and turn it into a site of affect, you know, and emotions. Okay, so the tripartite, you know, structure of the theme actually brings, you know, this commodity, you know, a bit further. So it is not just memories and also this return to the nature, but also it helps us, you know, to understand, you know, that kind of, well, global trans, well, global circulation, you know, of objects, you know, as well. So the documentary itself draws our attention to a range of people. So the factory workers in Guangdong, the fashion models in Paris, and also the miners in Shanxi. So through the interweaving of the three locations and the various processes of fabrication, exhibition, and consumption, Jia Zhangke explores intricate socio-economic relationship and the combined influence of global, regional, national, and also local concern. So the first part, you know, of the documentary is presented in an observational style and features a group of manual workers in a garment factory in the Zhuhai city, you know, in Guangdong province. Okay, so these workers produce Marker's first ready-to-wear fashion line. Okay, so it depicts, you know, the experience of the workers, you know, who produce, okay, these garments. The second segment covers the fashion show, okay, in France and England, where attendees are invited to meet the designer, but then not the workers who produce, you know, these fashion clothings. So the absence of the workers there, you know, in the second segment actually serve, you know, as a kind of critique, you know, by the filmmaker, you know, which, you know, the kind of promises, the mission that Marker wanted, you know, to create actually is not completed. The first segment actually deals with the life of the working class in Fengyang in Shanxi province in northern China. With the rise of the market economy, the local tailors in Shanxi, so actually, you know, you see on the far right, The local tailors in Shanxi cannot compete with the factories and department store in more developed parts of China. So to make a living, they have to turn to coal mining instead. So the dirt on their coal miners' uniform and their blackened faces and bodies after work is actually being presented, you know, as in stark contrast, you know, to the artificial dirt on Marcus' clothes that, you know, she wanted, you know, to have it, you know, by burying them, you know, into the soil. So there is that kind of contrast that Jia Zhangke, you know, is making, you know, in his documentary. So I think, you know, the documentary successfully reinforces the connection fought between people through objects and the affective bonds that have developed in a capitalistic age. But I think, you know, it also goes beyond that to critique, over-romanticization, you know, of Marcus' work, you know, is also not helpful, okay, to put it this way. Now, I will quickly, you know, move on, you know, to the theme that you're going to watch, you know, very soon. By thinking about the ways that Jia Zhangke uses a dialogic approach to open up the discussion of displacement and to comment critically, but not necessarily very pessimistically, on the diaspora, you know, experiences, you know, relating to the characters, you know, in the film. So I still, you know, bring in, you know, this notions of dialogism, you know, by Bakhtin here, because I think, you know, it would also be quite useful when Bakhtin's idea about how the use of polyphonic voices can be a very powerful challenge to the oppression of hegemonic discourse, which I think is what many of Jia Zhangke's films are trying to achieve, you know, to have that kind of polyphonic voices against a hegemonic discourse, okay, which is, of course, well, often, you know, is that the case. So I think, you know, Bakhtin's argument continues to inspire us with the stress, you know, on this responsible, you know, engagement. And for Jia Zhangke, displacement is a condition that can no longer be denied. It is just a commonplace that happened on a daily basis. So when you watch the film, you will find there are recurring images of a ruined countryside in a touch of scene, which are juxtaposed, you know, with images of suffocating urban spaces, which, of course, cannot help but remind the audience of this inescapable destiny of Chinese workers, that no matter where you are, you're still, well, trapped, you know, by that. So these diaspora experiences in combination with the economic forces and political realities have shaped somehow the Chinese itself. And to understand the various forces that contribute to this collective identity, so Jia Zhangke, you know, focuses on imaginative visions of home, which can be achieved through the connections of the physical, you know, and the affective. Now, in the film, there are four main characters and four main lines, you know, of narratives, which seems, you know, to be sort of like alienated, you know, from each other. But then they're also, of course, you know, connected, you know, by fate, that all of them at the end have to resort, you know, to violence, you know, to escape, you know, from the difficulties, you know, in life. So I would argue that documenting, you know, the kind of forces, the violence in the film, I don't think, you know, it is just simply trying to preserve, you know, the film, you know, as kind of indictments of the system. But then I think Jia Zhangke actually focuses on the creative determination and perseverance of the people who reimagine their roots in flexible relationship and also try very hard, you know, to rebuild, you know, relationship, you know, with one another. So there are a lot of this kind of dialogical imaginings. You know, on the one hand, it is about, you know, being trapped, but on the other hand, you know, is all this perseverance in trying to connect, trying to fight back, that you can see, you know, in Jia Zhangke. So in the beginning, they remain strangers, but then they are also clearly, you know, share the same kind of destiny and recourse to violence, such as a kind of alternative kind of connection, if we may look at that. Now, so A Touch of Scene actually revolves around these four characters from very different geographical and social background, who are all driven to violent acts. So Hu Dahai is an ex-miner in a village in Shaanxi province, is a loner who seeks to expose the collision of the chief of the village. And then because repeatedly, you know, being disappointed, you know, by the system, so he has to resort to violence and takes justice into his own hands. Zhou Shan, you know, is the one, the second, you know, from the right, is a professional thief and killer who travels back to his ruined and deserted home village near Chongqing. Xiao Yu, you know, is the female character there, is a receptionist in a massage parlor who refuses to prostitute herself And then Babin ended up, you know, beaten with a stack of cash, you know, by one of the customer. Okay. The story of Xiao Hui, which is, you know, the youngest, you know, workers on the right, is based on a more widely reported suicide that occurred, you know, in the Shenzhen plant operated by Foxconn, which was quite big, you know, in the news in a while ago. So enchanted by the promises of consumerism, Xiao Hui, you know, cannot deal with the reality of failure. So while drifting from city to city to get a job, just at the end, you know, he just being disillusioned, you know, by what is being promised, you know, by the society. Okay, so these are basically, you know, the four lines, you know, of narrative. So thinking about, you know, the affective site, you know, how spaces are being created for reconnections and what kind of reconnections, I would want to draw your attention actually, you know, towards the end, you know, of the film, when at the conclusion of the film, Xiao Yu, you know, the female character is part of the audience of a performance of the classical opera Yu Tang Chun, which tells the story of a young woman unjustly charged, you know, for crimes she did not commit, which is an ironic inversion of the stories depicted in the film that you will be able, you know, to discern later. So the stage itself becomes a site where the past and the present, fiction and reality meet. Before Xiao Yu reaches, you know, the public stage of the performance of opera, she walks beside the city wall, which is a symbol of the past, and battling a sandstorm created by present-day resources extraction. So she is being positioned at the crossroad of China's past and its unknown future. And later on, with the cameras alternating between the performance on stage and also the audience off stage, the film draws attention to the influence of art as an emotion and to the continued toleration of violence and injustice. So I think the function of the stage reminds the audience the continued injustice, you know, in life, experienced, you know, by, well, the people in China. It also brings back, you know, the kind of a lot, you know, of resonance and memories about this great, you know, Chinese traditional folk art, which is channeled, you know, through this classical opera, Yu Tang Chun. So, critics, you know, Tony Ryan's observed that very, you know, succinctly. So what is missing, so he said, what is missing from this picture on stage and screen is the rule of law. So the stage somehow, you know, has to connect the tradition and popular culture, past and present, the suffering and the perseverance in a way to bring the audience, you know, to the attention of this issue of the rule of law or the lack of it, you know, in, as you know, you can see, you know, in the film. So there are actually other objects. So that is the site, you know, where, you know, that kind of connections, you know, can be made between the past and the present, the traditions, you know, and the contemporary. There are also other kind of objects that are used, you know, to create that kind of temporal and cultural, you know, connections as well. So for one is in relation to the character Da Hai. Da Hai, you know, is modeled on the outlaws in the Chinese classics, the water margin. Okay, Shui Hu Zhuan. There are shots, you know, of Da Hai are repeatedly juxtaposed with the shots of a roaring tiger. Okay, a roaring tiger there. There are ample scenes showing him covered, you know, his hunting rifle with the tiger patterned cloth and sort of like stalks and walks around the village in pursuit of a vendetta, evoking, of course, the legendary tiger killer Wu Song, you know, in the water margin. So these references to classical literature evoke, of course, a very unique, you know, sort of like Chinese spirit, xia. Okay, the spirit of knight errantry in the Chinese martial arts traditions. So the celebration of xia, you know, is part of this very long tradition of wu xia genre, you know, in Chinese language film industry. It also served, you know, as a social critique, you know, of injustice that was being endured, you know, by the helpless, you know, abandoned people, you know, in the world. So as you will see, there are a lot of references, you know, to not only this Chinese classics, but also to the film genre itself, wuxia film genre. As again, like Tony Ryan's notes, that A Touch of Sin is actually laced, you know, with homages, you know, to King Hu and also other classical wuxia directors in our long, you know, Chinese language, you know, film history. And also, you know, apart from, you know, from Da Hai, when you look at the female character, Xiao Yu, you can also link, you know, her appearances, you know, the way that, you know, she is being dressed up to a female knight errant, Yang Huaizhen, you know, in King Wu's film, A Touch of Zen. So as you know, just, you know, from comparing, you know, the title, you know, A Touch of Zen, and then the English title, you know, of tonight's screening, you know, A Touch of Scene, you can also sense, you know, that is a tribute, you know, that Jia Zhangke would like to make, you know, to these, you know, masters, you know, of wuxia genre. So, and there are also, you know, other things like the kind of very stylized stepping, you know, that you will see in the film later, that actually sort of like reminds, you know, the audience that kind of wuxia tradition. That is also very, you know, significant, you know, to well, the development, you know, of the genre itself. So, quickly, solving the accents, you know, of wuxia actually confirms, you know, that A Touch of Scene, you know, is a film that actually concerned with the state of the masses, that the four protagonists are not isolated but intimately related to one another, that the Jia Zhangke ties, you know, these four characters, you know, together through registered chance encounters and also shared fates. So actually, you know, the character that connects them is actually Zhao Shan, who is the professional killer. You will see that, you know, he crossed paths, you know, with Da Hai and as an onlooker at an accident. He also ride on a long distance bus to Yichang with a Xiao Yu's lover and former boss. And then, you know, there are also other occasions, you know, that you see, you know, they are being, well, sort of like connected briefly, you know, in the film. For this kind of connections, I think, you know, it is very clear that the film would like to highlight the kind of dehumanization and retaliatory, you know, violence is almost inevitable, you know, because somehow what the kind of injustice are becoming a kind of epidemic, you know, that has spread throughout, you know, China, from coal mining town in Shanxi, you know, to Shenzhen, you know, where, you know, Xiao Hui, you know, had worked. So so you probably, you know, you, I hope to hear, you know, how do you find, you know, this very weird, you know, figure, you know, Zhao Shan, you know, that who actually, you know, connects all these characters, you know, together, because, you know, he has this obsession, you know, with guns. And for one thing that he talks about is that, you know, my obsession with guns is just because they aren't boring. Well, implying that, you know, the rest, you know, of the real life, you know, is boring. So this pretense of a prosperous and happy society is exposed as a forced, okay, whether one is rich or not. So guns, you know, seems to offer a means of escape, you know, from the pathetic fate of this real youth, you know, which is emblematic, you know, of Zhao Shan, in the capitalist, you know, China. So by and large, you know, these characters are disillusioned with the claims of progress. So they're using their own means, you know, to try to get back the life, you know, that they want. So quickly, you know, the conclusion. I think all these themes that I mentioned this evening depict demolition and urbanization as a way of life for migrant workers and displacement as an ontological, you know, conditions. So, but what is interesting, you know, in these three themes is there is this effective impetus that reconnects displaced people. It can be an object, it can be a commodity, it can be a performance that is mobile, malleable, and flexible enough to encourage alternative visions. So I think Jia Zhangke very successfully portrays the human need for reconciliation, which allows for change and a continuous reinvention of form. So objects like a banknote would provide an alternative safe for connection for disconnected people in still life. Useless portrays the fashion designer Ma Ke, who wants to re-enchant fashion in order to reconnect with earlier times and with emotions, with physical experiences, touching. And the documentary, you know, however, also warns us that not to overly, you know, romanticize, you know, objects as well. And in A Touch of Scene, history and traditions are evoked, you know, by the references to the classical literature and also the genre of wuxia. So I think all these references to different reinventions of the knight errant and codes of martial arts, the film itself connects the widely desperate characters and hints at a common fate of the Chinese people and also the importance of human choices. So thank you very much.
Yep.
It's a long film.
Yeah. So yes.
I hope you enjoyed it. You know, I mean, this is such a fascinating and also very powerful movie for me. Yeah.
Yeah, I would first like to thank you again for your introduction and also thank all of you to stay. And since it's quite late, I think I just start with one simple question before I open the floor to you, and we'll see. First, you talked about like migration on the one hand and also the circulation of objects in your presentation or in your lecture. And I would like to start with this. And well, to me at least, I'm not sure what you think about it, but this film is quite different as far as like the circulation of objects or the emotion that objects can create is concerned. At least to me, most of these objects are more like separating the people. For example, if you think about the mobile phone, that either like causes an accident or triggers an accident somehow, and also separates this young worker from his mother more than it links him to his mother. But there's one object which is quite different, which is the iPad in quite towards the end of the film, when the worker and this girl working in Dongguan, I think, yeah, in at Foxconn or whatever, when they talk to each other, and there's a kind of a relationship established between them. And this relationship very much also relates to some kind of translocal, to me at least, to some translocal yearnings, because they watch the news and read the news about like different places in China, actually. So there is this kind of subject matter again, that all the people they want to move to find a better life. And this is also mirrored by the movement in the film and the structure of the film, when we start in Shanxi in the north, in a quite poor area, and then we move further to central China and then to the south. But in the end, we are back at Shanxi, actually. So I mean, there are different ways to read this, but I would like ask you about your reading.
Thank you so much.
Circular.
I think in terms of the circulation of objects, maybe, you know, it's a bit different, you know, from the other two films, you know, that I mentioned. Different, you know, from Still Life and also, you know, from Wu Yong, from Useless. In a way, I also agree with you. The way that iPad, you know, has a very sort of like symbolic meaning, you know, in the film. In a way, you know, it is about, you know, of course, you know, information technology, you know, that is being dominating the younger generation. And on the other hand, you know, it's also a very good medium, you know, through which, you know, we actually have this experiences, you know, with what's actually happening, you know, in China. So on all these different kind of incidents and also problems, you know, that has been channeled through it. So that's why, you know, if you go back, you know, to the lecture, you know, I'm actually, you know, sort of like shifting a bit, you know, from objects, you know, to affective spaces. So I think, you know, what is more prominent in the film is definitely the kind of affective site, you know, that is enable, like, you know, that kind of relationship. And for me, you know, it is definitely the stage, you know, like the beginning, you know, you have, you know, this opera, you know, about Wu Song, you know, at the end, you know, have this opera, you know, about, you know, Yutangchun. So both of which, you know, it's very important, you know, connections about cultural memories, and also very rarely, you know, seen, you know, in Jia Zhangke's movie. So I think, you know, that is like a very explicit connection that he wants to make, you know, in this film, you know, linking, you know, this past and present, and probably maybe the future as well, for the kind of issues and problems, you know, that the masses, you know, face, and then justice, you know, is not, you know, being taken care of. Yeah, so that would be, you know, something that I'd be thinking along, you know, this line of thought.
I would have a question to that, but maybe first we wait. But there are further questions here in the audience, please.
Just a very simple question. I mean, you talked about material objects in a very compelling way. Can you say something about animals? The horse, the ape. The monkey and the cow.
Definitely. I think, you know, all of us, you know, in the room would have the feeling that animals, you know, has an important role to play. You know, at least, you know, each of this character, you know, is linked, you know, to a type, you know, of animal in one way or the other. So for me, on one hand, you know, it's about, you know, this common experience of exploitation. So, you know, both, you know, animals and human beings, you know, share that kind, similar kind of exploitation. You know, animals are being exploited by human being, and then, humans are being exploited by other human beings, you know, so that is shared. And it is also interesting to see entrapment and then also liberty, you know, in the same time. So somehow, if you remember, so the horses was being saved, you know, by Da Hai, you know, after, you know, he shot, you know, the owner, you know, who repeatedly, you know, sort of flipped the horse, and then also the snake, you know. So on one hand, you see the snake, you know, trapped in this like small van, you know, where, you know, it signified a kind of like prophecy, you know, if you go into that van, you know, you can ask, you know, this green snake, you know, about, you know, your future. You know, that is, you know, the kind of literature that is also linked, you know, to that particular figure there. And then later you see the snake actually sort of like escape after, you know, Xiao Yu actually committed, you know, the killing. So, I mean, for me, you know, that is also that kind of comparison. So where is, where can one be free, you know? Is animal more free, you know, than human, you know, in that particular circumstances? You know, so are we necessarily, you know, more sort of like more superior, you know, than animals? I think, you know, that is the question that I think is being suggested, you know, in the film as well. So, but definitely, I think you don't see animals very often, you know, in Jia Zhangke's movies. You know, in other films, you know, that probably, you know, you might have, you know, watched before. Yeah, but this one, you know, it's like, you know, is a very important symbol, you know, in the film. So definitely, you know, try to, you know, rewatch it, you know, and to think about, you know, all these animals that appear there as well. Yeah. Thank you.
Are there any further comments or questions or responses to the film? Yeah, please.
Yeah, thank you. So actually, I guess I thought it was really interesting what you just said, this idea that maybe the animals are more free in a way because they can escape. And I was just thinking about the end of the film, because it seems like, I mean, as you already pointed out also, I mean, we end up in the same place as we started, and it began with this scene where the person, one of the workers, ran away because apparently he had committed some sort of crime, and now she is arriving there as someone who has committed a crime, and she ends up in the same company, probably doing the same kind of labor, or she will probably end up, and it seems also like, I mean, of course she in a way she is not in prison, but it feels like it's kind of like a Strafkompanie or something, like I mean, she definitely isn't really free in the end, and so it almost feels like it is a kind of punishment. So also what you were saying in the beginning about this last scene, that it's because in the apparently in the opera, I mean, in the Chinese opera, it's about a woman being punished for a crime she didn't commit, and you said it's kind of like the inversion of what happens in the film, but then it's very ambivalent, right? Because in a way she is being punished, and also it is very uncertain. I mean, of course she committed the crime, but I mean, nobody is really free of guilt in that scenario, right? So it's very, I mean, it really raises or makes this question very complicated, like who is actually guilty, and is she really guilty, and to what extent, and so on. And I just wanted to hear your thoughts on this, and like, I don't know, because, you know, probably you thought about this more than I have, but yeah. So and then I have a second question also. I was curious about the role of religion, because I mean, I noticed, you know, there were several scenes with the temples, but then also there were these Christian symbols. Some, like, you had these nuns, the two nuns in the beginning when the horse was running away, and also in the very beginning this image of, I think it was Mother Mary with the child or something on this truck. And it just was very surprising to me to see that. And I was just curious if you could elaborate that.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah, very glad that, you know, you bring up the idea, what, you know, the question about, you know, religion. Yeah, because I think maybe, you know, you should also have remarked that there is also a monk, you know, riding on a motorbike, you know, in one of the scenes as well. Yeah, I think definitely there has much to do with Maoism, you know, and, you know, the falling, you know, of Maoism, you know, in mainland, in post-socialist China. So, because in the very beginning, you know, the image, you know, of Mary, you know, Jesus, you know, which is, you know, framed, you know, in that painting, is being shown, you know, juxtaposed, you know, to the statue, you know, in the, well, at the entrance, you know, of the city as well. So I think, you know, religion, you know, is a very complicated matter, you know, in mainland China. You know, on the one hand, we have the suppression, you know, of religion. And then on the other, you know, we also, you know, have this very prominent, you know, symbols that you can see, you know, anywhere, and also using, you know, mythicizing, you know, well, heroes, you know, and political figures in China as well. So I think there's a juxtaposition of that, you know, that's like a questioning of do we need religion? You know, what does religion do, you know, to the general, you know, public? So I think, you know, that is more like a question that is being raised, you know, in the film. And then going back to the notion of sin, you know, so who are the sinners, you know? So on the one hand, of course, you know, Xiaoyu, you know, that she committed the crime, you know, she is the sinner, you know, she killed, you know, the man. But then, you know, with the very last scene, you know, the shot that you can see in the film, I think, you know, Jia Zhangke, you know, is actually suggesting, you know, who actually are the sinners. It is actually the onlookers, you know, because, you know, that is a... in modern Chinese literature, you know, Lu Xun, you know, has this very famous piece of work, you know, criticizing, you know, the onlookers, you know, the character, you know, of Chinese people who doesn't really engage and try to do something, you know, when you see their issues, you know, their problems, you know, in life. And those onlookers are actually the culprits, you know, who let, you know, these things, you know, to continue to happen. So I think we know with that particular last scene that, you know, with the focus, you know, on the audience, you know, like this monotonous, you know, emotionless, you know, faces. I think, you know, that is what is being suggested. You know, these, the problem is actually on those, you know, who don't do anything and allowing, you know, the problems, you know, to proceed. You know, maybe, you know, those onlookers are the one, you know, who have sins, you know, that have to reflect on that. You know, that is, you know, from, you know, my reading of it. Yeah, thank you for the question. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. There's one more.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, just to respond to this, maybe, I mean, I think, of course, also maybe the audience sees it. I mean, I felt like I'm being reflected also by this, like they're staring at the camera, like we're staring at the screen. So it's maybe also like the not just the depicted audience, but also the audience that is looking at it, right? That is kind of being held as a culprit. But then also I felt like it was not so monotonous, actually, but I had the feeling that the people... also because they were, how they were proceeding to the scene before. I mean, I had the impression that they were looking so very different. Mm-hmm. You know, like it seemed like they were maybe also from many different parts of China and maybe not even only China. Just, you know, but like maybe it was coincidence, but it felt like he seemed to have chosen a lot of different faces and looks somehow. Yeah, I don't know about the religion. Now it comes back to me because you used the word sin, right? And that's also in the title, but then sin is a very religious concept somehow, different from guilt or like the juridical concept of guilt. And I don't know, maybe it seemed also that those figures, these kind of like action heroes, somehow they were not acting in a way, not, I mean, they were not, they, it was totally out of the context of law. I mean, it was kind of like self-proclaimed justice or something. And I mean, I don't know, I would be curious maybe what you think about if that is somehow related to a religious notion of justice or something. I don't know.
I didn't think about that, you know, before, because there is the kind of discrepancy between the Chinese film title and the English film title. Yeah, so for me, I mean, the English translation, you know, is really a kind of tribute, you know, to King Hu, you know, A Touch of Zen. So that's why, you know, in order to fit into that pattern, you know, that I think, you know, sin is being used, you know, to, of course, you know, to talk about violence that is being committed in the film. But if you look at, you know, the Chinese title, you know, it's more about fate. Tiān Zhùdìng, you know, is like, you know, it is fate. You know, it is fate, you know, that all these people had to resort, you know, to violence in order to save themselves or to save, you know, others. So I think, you know, there are slightly, you know, different, you know, meanings in the two titles. Yeah, but I think, you know, religion, you know, it's definitely, you know, something that Jia Zhangke would like to address, you know, in the film by, you know, juxtaposing, you know, so many different symbols. Yeah, and also the diversity of it. I mean, so that is actually quite amazing, you know, to see the kind of differences, you know, that he wants to bring in. So, and also diversity, I think, you know, that is also makes a lot of sense, you know, because if you, for those, you know, who speak Mandarin, you know that there are different dialects that is being used, you know, in the film. So different, actually, you know, different character, you know, use a different dialect. So I think, you know, Jia Zhangke is also wants, you know, to keep that kind of differences and nuance, you know, in languages, you know, in the film as well, you know, just to tell, you know, it is a diverse group of people, but then have a kind of shared fate, you know, because, you know, of the structure's problem, you know, because of the system itself. Yeah, so thank you for that.
May I just briefly add to what you, well, you mentioned like lawlessness or acting against the law. And I think still, I would agree that I would not really directly related to the title, but it's very much related to the idea of Jianghu that we find here. So to this place where people in Wuxia film or also in the Water Margin that we find many references to here in the film, that they, they roam the country and they murder or do robberies, etc., for the sake of good, actually, more or less. That's at least what they sometimes, yeah. Well, at least, they don't really stick to or they don't lead a lawful life, at least throughout most of the stories. In the end, usually there's a change, but in throughout the stories. But most of them are still depicted very often as kind of altruistic and having an ulterior motive, motivation, and this applies to part of the opera that we have seen, at least the first part, the Lin Chung, like the Dahai, when he watches the opera in the beginning, it's from Water Margin, which is a novel which is similar to this idea, and then we have. We have the Wuxia references that you mentioned several times. And to me, there is there is this connection of Jianghu between both, but there's also a tension between the opera and also the idea of Wuxia. I don't know what do you think about these like two elements, intermediate elements here in the film?
I think it is definitely Wuxia that we see, you know, the genre, you know, is being referenced. But I think, you know, it is also a twist, you know, of the Wuxia genre, you know. In a way, even though, you know, we can consider them, you know, as knight errants, you know, who try to resort to violence, you know, just to do justice. But I would also say they are like wounded people, that they're like wounded, you know, knights, you know. So even Daha, you know, you find him, you know, sort of like waving, you know, that rifles, you know, but then, you know, he is someone that with diabetes, you know, he's wounded. So for me, there is also that kind of reflexivity, you know, of the genre, you know, whether these are heroes or, you know, they are just actually human beings, you know, that who didn't have other choices but being pushed, you know, or cornered, you know, by the social systems. So I think in that sense, it actually links, you know, to like the Water Margin story, when these outlaws, you know, become outlaws because of lack of choices, you know. So it is not that they chose, you know, to be outlaws, but they're being forced, you know, to be. So I think that in that sense, you know, that is being connected. So a lot of things are out of our control. Yeah, so that is also part of the fate, I think, you know, that the film, you know, is addressing as well. Yeah.
I just thought about, because the opera scenes, they are always set in Shanxi and not in central China, not in South China. So to me, it was like part of this like more stifling or tradition coming back to Shanxi, not as the promised land, but there is the wall as well. So there's this tradition that really makes you, I don't know, at least uncomfortable, if not more, even more. So that's why, to me, like the opera excerpts are much, much more problematic maybe than the Wuxia elements, which are related to also mobility, at least, even if not in a very happy sense, but yeah.
I think, you know, if you're thinking about, you know, the cultural traditions, you know, through opera, you know, actually there are many layers, you know, of cultural memories that Jia Zhangke, you know, has used, you know, in the film. So on one hand, of course, you know, this older form, you know, the traditional literature, and then the wuxia genre, and then also the popular memories as well. So if you recall, you know, there is a scene that, you know, Zhou Xian, you know, the professional killer, you know, is actually looking at the screen on the bus, you know, when he's sort of like leaving one place, you know, to another. So actually what he's showing, you know, on the screen is actually Johnny To's movie. Yeah, so there is actually another layer that, you know, Jia Zhangke would like to bring, you know, the audience into. So so both, you know, old and the contemporary one, I mean, he's trying to, I think, you know, the film, you know, is helping us, you know, to connect all these different cultural memories, you know, across time, yeah, and all these actually help shape people, yeah. So I would be thinking of that, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, please. Huh? Oh, sorry. Next question.
No, just because, about this religion question, because while you were talking, I just remembered this one scene where the I don't remember his name now, but he was where he was praying, and his wife said it's too early to pray to the gods or something. It's not yet New Year's, and then he said, "I'm not praying to the gods. I'm praying to the ghosts." And I was wondering about the statues of the ghost. I mean, is that like part of religion in a sense or not? And what does it mean to be like praying to the ghosts, and this like refusal to like pray to the gods, but rather to the ghosts? I don't know. I was just curious.
I don't know. Because for one thing, that I don't think, you know, he's Zhou Shan, you know, that the scene that you mentioned is Zhou Shan going back to his mother's, you know, birthday. And then, you know, so he's like taking the three cigarettes and trying to pray and say, you know, I'm not praying to God, but I'm praying to ghosts. I think it for me, you know, it actually tells more about the kind of rebellious character of Zhou Shan, you know, because, you know, on the one hand, people would only try to pray to God, which is a part of our cultural traditions. But he would just say, you know, I just ignore it. You know, I just do whatever I want, just without any particular reason, just like, you know, why he's obsessed with guns. I don't have a reason, you know, just because I'm bored with my everyday life, so I turn to guns, which makes me happy. So I think, you know, that's, for me, you know, that is more that sense in it. Yeah. But then they may also link to other kind of like popular imaginations, like about, you know, for people, you know, who committed crimes, who are gangsters, usually, you know, you have to pray to certain kind of gods, you know, to protect you. So, but usually, you know, there's gods, you know, rather than ghosts. So in this sense, you know, I think, you know, it is just the way that he said it. So I just ignore rules, you know, I just ignore common practices. I just stick to what I believe in. So, yeah. So I think we reflect more about Zhou Shan's character and personality. Yeah.
Just one little last question. One of the pleasures of watching Jia Zhangke's films is to wait for his cameo. And here he plays the manager of the Golden Age brothel and resort. Do you have something to say about that? Why it's an interesting way of presenting himself in the universe that he so critically presents to us.
Say that, you know, it's if what we've seen, you know, there, you know, at the what's sort of like brothel, you know, is about entertainment. So if it's like kind of self-reflexivity, you know, that theme, you know, is about entertainment, right? Yeah. And he's comfortable, you know, being, you know, the boss, you know, of these, you know, to be on top, you know, of the things. But I think it surprised, you know, most of the audience, you know, where we see, oh, you know, that he is actually, you know, there, you know, and then really, you know, is he there, you know, playing this kind of character? Yeah. But for me, I mean, that's that kind of self-mockery there, you know, right? So I'm here, you know, I'm trying to entertain you, and are you being entertained? You know, I mean, that kind of sarcasm there. Okay. Yeah. I'm just curious, anyone wants to talk about the violence in the film? You know, are you shocked by it, or are you okay in a way?
Can I just ask a very simple question?
Yeah, sure.
I'm just wondering who made the subtitle in German.
So, yeah. really don't know.
This film was actually released in Germany, so it was by the distribution company that did the subtitles. Were there many things wrong or what?
Yeah, well, is there any?
Other films are.
Let everybody in the back.
I noticed only this one is in German.
Oh,
subtitle? No?
The last film was also the platform we also screened in German.
Okay, yeah, maybe I neglect. Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Yeah.
There are unfortunately not so many of his films that have been released in Germany, so not for many of them we're just screening with English subtitles, but for those that have German subtitles, yeah, we're also taking the chance. So. Yeah. Does anybody want to talk about the violence part, or
I'm not forcing you.
No, I can say something. I mean, if I may, because it is shocking, but like I thought it was funny because when we see the first shotgun scene, I thought somehow of like Tarantino, and then I was thinking, well, but probably Tarantino was actually inspired by the things that Jia Zhangke is actually referring to. So I was making like a whole crisscross in my mind, like what references are we talking about here with this kind of open, not just the violence, and then he makes sure to show the blood and he makes sure to go into the wounds, right? So it is quite a very specific way, and I don't know, I imagine there's much more reference that he's the films that you were talking about as a reference to this kind of violence, but
I think part of it I would find the similarities, you know, between, you know, that kind of brutality and the gangster movies, you know, in Hong Kong, you know, like by John Woo, Johnny To, you know. So I think that probably, you know, are some of the references, you know, that Jia Zhangke uses. But then also, you know, in the same time, you know, when I look at, you know, these visual, you know, shock, you know, I think, you know, that's also so much, you know, the Hollywood, you know, Western, you know, elements in there. You know, it reminds me of like Leon the Professional, you know, when the Zhou Shan character definitely, you know, is being modeled, you know, after him as well. So I think, you know, there are actually a lot, you know, as well, given, you know, Jia Zhangke, you know, is such a well-read, you know, and well sort of like director, you know, who watches, you know, so many films. Yeah.
Maybe just one observation, yeah, regarding the violence. German film critics like to criticize films for senseless violence. You know, there's the concept of senseless violence as such is an interesting concept because it implies that there is violence that makes sense and there's justifiable violence. But I would say that in this particular case, and probably that's the reason why nobody complained about the violence, it seems like the violence of the main character is amply justified. And, you know, in the first segment, obviously, the people who get their comeuppance, some of it is excessive, or, you know, he kills the wife who didn't do anything wrong, and he kills the clerk who was just being an asshole and probably didn't deserve to die. But it's understandable that he snaps. And so in that sense, I think the violence is graphic, but it is part of the universe as it is presented to us. And sadly, it makes sense.
Did you want to respond to that first? Or
No,
I think that's exactly the point. I mean, I was thinking the same thing, and I was also thinking somehow that because I never understood these like films where there's so much blood and so much violence, and it always somehow appalled me, and I didn't really get it. And now suddenly I think like, okay, maybe I understand why people want to watch it, because there is all this like brutality and violence in our culture, in the way everything is organized, and like a lot of people experience certain forms of like structural violence or actual violence and so on. And then, but then in a lot of films, the way it is presented is in ways that it is projected onto groups that are not the cause of the violence, right? And so in a way, I mean, I don't really think that it was just or something. I mean, you don't really get the feeling that it's the proper way to act or something, but somehow you understand the, I mean, you get the feeling that in this case, as opposed to other films, the aggression and the violence that is produced by society is directed not towards the people who are already suffering from it most or something. Like, I don't know. I still think it's maybe problematic. I don't know. I think it's not a... Yeah, I think... Yeah, anyway.
Uh-huh. Yeah, no, thank you for that. Yeah.
It's just in a, again, so...
Sorry, me again. another standard criticism is the criticism about the aestheticization of violence, you know, making violence too attractive, which is probably not what you would say about this film at first sight. But then one thing you have to say about Jia Zhangke is that he's a master of patterning and of rhythm and of rhyming. And what you could say about this film is that it is structured as a diptych, because the trajectory of the first character is reprised and reiterated with a variation in the Zhao Tao character. You know, they're being humiliated, they're subject to aggression, and then they respond to the violence. And in a way, the trajectory is similar, and there's a repetition in it, and so it has this grand scale of a diptych of violence, which, by the way, also made me think of Dong, which is also structured as a diptych with certain you know, elements, like there's a great pan in Dong from the painting to the model. And then the model stands up and walks away, and that is repeated in the second segment. And you have these grand rhythmic patterns and repetitions in the films, and that makes this, I think, even more interesting as a way of dealing with violence and representing violence. I don't know, that's just a loose observation, sorry.
No, I agree, because I think, you know, Jia Zhangke is actually preparing, you know, the audience, you know, to accept, you know, the aggression of violence, you know, in your film. So maybe the first one, you know, you find it a bit, you know, shocking, you know, because of this suddenness, you know, that, well, Daha, you know, decided, you know, to use the rifle. But then, you know, in the with the second, you know, story and the third, you know, that going onwards, I think, you know, the audience are being prepared, you know, to experience violence, you know, as a way to get justice. So I think, you know, that is also his kind of rhythm, you know, that, you know, is, well, repeated with a difference. Okay, yeah. But then, you know, it also, you know, makes it so exciting, because you know you're expecting maybe something is going to be repeated, but in what way and how is it going to be realized, you know, differently. So that is also preparing, you know, that kind of expectations, you know, from for the audience as well. Yeah.
Okay. Any further questions? If this is not the case, thank you very much for. Oh yeah, there was one. Yeah, so.
What I wanted to get at, and I think I didn't, maybe also because I'm really tired now, but is that, I mean, somehow, because somehow with like most, I guess with these films where there's a lot of violence, there also is this maybe idea that is a kind, that it can have a kind of cathartic effect or something, or that like a certain aggression or anger that is, that builds up in people can be sort of like drained by watching these films. I mean, instead of like watching a film and then going like to take political action, maybe people can be just like satisfied because their negative effects have been sort of purged. But with this film, because somehow the right, I mean, the actual cause of the anger or of the aggression is addressed, it is maybe a more politicizing effect in the end or something. Like, it is not so, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. It's a hypothesis. I don't know. Maybe you would not agree with
it. Just keep thinking, you know, about it. You know, I think that's the nice thing about the film, right? You know, because it just opened up, you know, so many possible, you know, approaches, you know, to it. Yeah, so definitely, you know, we should continue to think about that. Yeah.
Okay, so we do that, and I thank you very, very much, and thank you to Dr. Yip.
Thank you so much for staying.
And yeah, I wish you a good night.